Andrei Tarkovsky, Andrei Arsenyevich Tarkovsky, April 4, 1932, December 29, 1986, was a Russian filmmaker, writer, film editor, film theorist, theater and opera director. His work is characterized by long takes, unconventional dramatic structure, distinctly authored use of cinematography, and spiritual and metaphysical themes. His contribution to cinema was so influential that works done in a similar way are described as Tarkovskian. Director Ingmar Bergman said of him, "Tarkovsky for me is the greatest director, the one who invented a new language, true to the nature of film, as it captures life as a reflection, life as a dream." Tarkovsky's art is a significant and unusual phenomenon of world culture. His films form as a magnum opus of the cycle of suffering and hopes of a person who assumes the burden of moral responsibility for the whole world. Conceptual and artistic solutions of Tarkovsky differ in originality and depth. The events of his films are immersed in an atmosphere of mystery and ambiguity, which prompts the viewer to look for different, sometimes mutually exclusive interpretations. His films include Ivan's Childhood, 1962, Andrei Rublev, 1966, Solaris, 1972, Mirror, 1975, and Stalker, 1979. He directed the first five of his seven feature films in the Soviet Union. His last two films, Nostalgia, 1983, and The Sacrifice, 1986, were produced in Italy and Sweden, respectively. The films Andrei Rublev, Solaris, Mirror, and Stalker are regularly listed among the greatest films of all time and became classics and examples for imitation in the world of cinema. Andrei Tarkovsky was born in the village of Zavrosy in the Yuryevetsky district of the Ivanova Industrial Oblast, modern-day Kadiysky district of the Kostroma Oblast, Russia, to the poet and translator Arseny Alexandrovich Tarkovsky, a native of Yeliseyevgrad, Kherson Governorate, and Maria Ivanova Vishnyakova, a graduate of the Maxim Gorky Literature Institute who later worked as a corrector. She was born in Moscow in the Dubasov family estate. Andrei's paternal grandfather Alexander Karlovich Tarkovskian was a Polish nobleman who worked as a bank clerk. His wife Maria Danilovna Rachkovskaya was a Romanian teacher who arrived from Yashi. Andrei's maternal grandmother Vera Nikolaevna Vishnyakova, née Dubasova, belonged to an old Dubasov family of Russian nobility that traces its history back to the 17th century. Among her relatives was Admiral Fyodor Dubasov, a fact she had to conceal during the Soviet days. She was married to Ivan Ivanovich Vishnyakov, a native of the Kaluga Governorate who studied law at the Moscow University and served as a judge in Kosolsk. According to the family legend, Tarkovsky's ancestors on his father's side were princes from the Shamkalat of Tarki, Dagestan, although his sister Marina Tarkovskaya, who did a detailed research on their genealogy, called it a myth, even a prank of sorts, stressing that none of the documents confirms this version. Tarkovsky spent his childhood in Yuryevets. He was described by childhood friends as active and popular, having many friends and being typically in the center of action. His father left the family in 1937, subsequently volunteering for the army in 1941. Tarkovsky stayed with his mother, moving with her and his sister Marina to Moscow, where she worked as a proofreader at a printing press. In 1939, Tarkovsky enrolled at the Moscow School No. 554. During the war, the three evacuated to Yuryevets, living with his maternal grandmother. In 1943, the family returned to Moscow. Tarkovsky continued his studies at his old school, where the poet Andrei Voznesensky was one of his classmates. He studied piano at a music school and attended classes at an art school. The family lived on Shipok Street in the Zamosk-Verechny district in Moscow. From November 1947 to spring 1948, he was in the hospital with tuberculosis. Many themes of his childhood, the evacuation, his mother and her two children, the withdrawn father, the time in the hospital, feature prominently in his film Mirror. In his school years, Tarkovsky was a troublemaker and a poor student. He still managed to graduate, and from 1951 to 1952 studied Arabic at the Oriental Institute in Moscow, a branch of the Academy of Sciences of the USSR. Although he already spoke some Arabic and was a successful student in his first semesters, he did not finish his studies and dropped out to work as a prospector for the Academy of Science Institute for Non-Ferrous Metals and Gold. He participated in a year-long research expedition to the River Karakai near Turakonsk in the Krasnoyarsk province. During this time in the taiga, Tarkovsky decided to study film. Upon returning from the research expedition in 1954, Tarkovsky applied at the State Institute of Cinematography, VGIK, and was admitted to the film directing program. He was in the same class as Irma Rausch, whom he married in April 1957. The early Khrushchev era offered good opportunities for young film directors. Before 1953, annual film production was low and most films were directed by veteran directors. After 1953, more films were produced, many of them by young directors. The Khrushchev thaw relaxed Soviet social restrictions a bit and permitted a limited influx of European and North American literature, films and music. This allowed Tarkovsky to see films of the Italian neorealists, French New Wave, and of directors such as Kurosawa, Buñuel, Bergman, Bresson, Andrzej Wajda, whose film Ashes and Diamonds influenced Tarkovsky, and Mizoguchi. Tarkovsky's teacher and mentor was Mikhail Rom, who taught many film students who would later become influential film directors. In 1956, Tarkovsky directed his first student short film, The Killers, from a short story of Ernest Hemingway. The short film There Will Be No Leave Today and the screenplay Concentrate followed in 1958 and 1959. An important influence on Tarkovsky was the film director Grigory Chukhrai, who was teaching at the GIK. Impressed by the talent of his student, Chukhrai offered Tarkovsky a position as assistant director for his film Clear Skies. Tarkovsky initially showed interest but then decided to concentrate on his studies and his own projects. During his third year at the GIK, Tarkovsky met Andrei Konkolovsky. They found much in common as they liked the same film directors and shared ideas on cinema and films. In 1959 they wrote the script Antarctica, Distant Country, which was later published in the Moskovsky Komsomolets. Tarkovsky submitted the script to Len Film, but it was rejected. They were more successful with the script The Steamroller and the Violin, which they sold to Mosfilm. This became Tarkovsky's graduation project, earning him his diploma in 1960 and winning first prize at the New York Student Film Festival in 1961. Tarkovsky's first feature film was Ivan's Childhood in 1962. He had inherited the film from director Edward Ablove, who had to abort the project. The film earned Tarkovsky international acclaim and won the Golden Lion Award at the Venice Film Festival in the year 1962. In the same year, on 30th of September, his first son Arseny, called Senka in Tarkovsky's diaries, Tarkovsky was born. In 1965, he directed the film Andrei Rublev about the life of Andrei Rublev, the 15th century Russian icon painter. Andrei Rublev was not, except for a single screening in Moscow in 1966, immediately released after completion due to problems with Soviet authorities. Tarkovsky had to cut the film several times, resulting in several different versions of varying lengths. A version of the film was presented at the Cannes Film Festival in 1969 and won the Fipresci Prize. The film was widely released in the Soviet Union in a cut version in 1971. He divorced his wife, Irma Rausch, in June 1970. In the same year, he married Larissa Kizilova, Nyagorkina, who had been a production assistant for the film Andrei Rublev. They had been living together since 1965. Their son, Andrei Andreyevich Tarkovsky, was born in the same year on 7 August. The film was presented an award at the Cannes Film Festival. In 1972, he completed Solaris, an adaptation of the novel Solaris by Stanislaw Lem. He had worked on this together with screenwriter Friedrich Gorenstein as early as 1968. The film was presented at the Cannes Film Festival, won the Grand Prix Special du Jury and the Fipresci Prize, and was nominated for the Palme d'Or. From 1973 to 1974, he shot the film Mirror, a highly autobiographical and unconventionally structured film drawing on his childhood and incorporating some of his father's poems. In this film Tarkovsky portrayed the plight of childhood affected by war. Tarkovsky had worked on the screenplay for this film since 1967, under the consecutive titles Confession, White Day and A White, White Day. From the beginning the film was not well received by Soviet authorities due to its content and its perceived elitist nature. Russian authorities placed the film in the third category, a severely limited distribution, and only allowed it to be shown in third-class cinemas and workers' clubs. Few prints were made and the filmmakers received no returns. Third category films also place the filmmakers in danger of being accused of wasting public funds, which could have serious effects on their future productivity. These difficulties are presumed to have made Tarkovsky play with the idea of going abroad and producing a film outside the Soviet film industry. During 1975, Tarkovsky also worked on the screenplay Hoffmanniana, about the German writer and poet E.T.A. Hoffmann. In December 1976, he directed Hamlet, his only stage play, at the Lenkom Theater in Moscow. The main role was played by Anatoly Solonitsyn, who also acted in several of Tarkovsky's films. At the end of 1978, he also wrote the screenplay Sardar together with the writer Alexander Mazharin. The last film Tarkovsky completed in the Soviet Union was Stalker, inspired by the novel Roadside Picnic by the brothers Arkady and Boris Strugetsky. Tarkovsky had met the brothers first in 1971 and was in contact with them until his death in 1986. Initially he wanted to shoot a film based on their novel Dead Mountaineer's Hotel, and he developed a raw script. Influenced by a discussion with Arkady Strugetsky, he changed his plan and began to work on the script based on Roadside Picnic. Work on this film began in 1976. The production was mired in troubles. Improper development of the negatives had ruined all the exterior shots. Tarkovsky's relationship with cinematographer Georgi Rieberberg deteriorated to the point where he hired Alexander Nyavinsky as a new first cinematographer. Furthermore, Tarkovsky suffered a heart attack in April 1978, resulting in further delay. The film was completed in 1979 and won the prize of the Ecumenical Jury of the Cannes Film Festival. In the same year, Tarkovsky also began the production of the film The First Day, Russian, Pervidayan, based on a script by his friend and long-term collaborator Andrei Konkolovsky. The film was set in 18th-century Russia during the reign of Peter the Great and starred Natalia Bondarchuk and Anatoly Papanov. To get the project approved by Goskino, Tarkovsky submitted a script that was different from the original script, omitting several scenes that were critical of the official atheism in the Soviet Union. After shooting roughly half of the film, the project was stopped by Goskino after it became apparent that the film differed from the script submitted to the censors. Tarkovsky was reportedly infuriated by this interruption and destroyed most of the film. During the summer of 1979, Tarkovsky traveled to Italy, where he shot the documentary Voyage in Time together with his longtime friend Nino Guerra. Tarkovsky returned to Italy in 1980 for an extended trip during which he and Guerra completed the script for the film Nostalgia. Tarkovsky returned to Italy in 1982 to start shooting Nostalgia. He did not return to his home country. As Mosfilm withdrew from the project, he had to complete the film with financial support provided by the Italian RAI. Tarkovsky completed the film in 1983. Nostalgia was presented at the Cannes Film Festival and won the FIPRISI Prize and the Prize of the Ecumenical Jury. Tarkovsky also shared a special prize called Grand Prix du Cinéma de Création with Robert Bresson. Soviet authorities prevented the film from winning the Palme d'Or, a fact that hardened Tarkovsky's resolve to never work in the Soviet Union again. He also said, "I am not a Soviet dissident, I have no conflict with the Soviet government. But if he returned home," he added, "no wiki I would be unemployed." /no wiki in the same year, he also staged the opera Boris Godunov at the Royal Opera House in London under the musical direction of Claudio Abbado. He spent most of 1984 preparing the film The Sacrifice. At a press conference in Milan on July 10, 1984, he announced that he would never return to the Soviet Union and would remain in Europe. At that time, his son Andrei Jr. was still in the Soviet Union and not allowed to leave the country. On August 28, 1985, Tarkovsky arrived at Latina refugee camp in Latina, where he was registered with the serial number 13225379. The Sacrifice was Tarkovsky's ultimate film, dedicated to Andrei Jr. In the subsequent documentary following the making of The Sacrifice, released posthumously, Tarkovsky expresses his sentiments on death, claiming he believed himself to be immortal. During 1985, he shot the film The Sacrifice in Sweden. At the end of the year, he was diagnosed with terminal lung cancer. In January 1986, he began treatment in Paris and was joined there by his son, who was finally allowed to leave the Soviet Union. The Sacrifice was presented at the Cannes Film Festival and received the Grand Prix Special du Jury, the FIPRISI Prize and the Prize of the Ecumenical Jury. As Tarkovsky was unable to attend due to his illness, the prizes were collected by his son, Andrei Jr. In Tarkovsky's last entry, December 15, 1986, he wrote, "But now I have no strength left, that is the problem. The diaries are sometimes also known as and were published posthumously in 1989 and in English in 1991. Tarkovsky died in Paris on December 29, 1986. His funeral ceremony was held at the Alexander Nevsky Cathedral. He was buried on January 3, 1987 in the Russian cemetery in Sainte-Geneviève-des-Bois in France. The inscription on his gravestone, which was conceived by Tarkovsky's wife, Larissa Tarkovskaya, reads, "To the man who saw the angel." A conspiracy theory emerged in Russia in the early 1990s when it was alleged that Tarkovsky did not die of natural causes but was assassinated by the KGB. Evidence for this hypothesis includes testimonies by former KGB agents who claim that Viktor Chebrikov gave the order to eradicate Tarkovsky to curtail what the Soviet government and the KGB saw as anti-Soviet propaganda by Tarkovsky. Other evidence includes several memoranda that surfaced after the 1991 coup and the claim by one of Tarkovsky's doctors that his cancer could not have developed from a natural cause. As with Tarkovsky, his wife Larissa Tarkovskaya and actor Anatoly Solonitsyn all died from the very same type of lung cancer. Vladimir Sharon, sound designer and stalker, is convinced that they were all poisoned by the chemical plant where they were shooting the film. Tarkovsky is mainly known as a film director. During his career he directed only 7 feature films, as well as 3 shorts from his time at GIK. These include he also wrote several screenplays. Furthermore, he directed the play Hamlet for the stage in Moscow, directed the opera Boris Godunov in London, and he directed a radio production of the short story Turnabout by William Faulkner. He also wrote Sculpting in Time, a book on film theory. Tarkovsky's first feature film was Ivan's Childhood in 1962. He then directed Andrei Rublev in 1966, Solaris in 1972, Mirror in 1975 and Stalker in 1979. The documentary Voyage in Time was produced in Italy in 1982, as was Nostalgia in 1983. His last film The Sacrifice was produced in Sweden in 1986. Tarkovsky was personally involved in writing the screenplays for all his films, sometimes with a co-writer. Tarkovsky once said that a director who realizes somebody else's screenplay without being involved in it becomes a mere illustrator, resulting in dead and monotonous films. A book of 60 photos, Instant Light, Tarkovsky Polaroids, taken by Tarkovsky in Russia and Italy between 1979 and 1984 was published in 2006. The collection was selected by Italian photographer Giovanni Chiaramondi and Tarkovsky's son Andrei A. Tarkovsky. Bibliography. Books written by Tarkovsky. Numerous awards were bestowed on Tarkovsky throughout his lifetime. At the Venice Film Festival he was awarded the Golden Lion for Ivan's Childhood. At the Cannes Film Festival, he won the Fipresci Prize 4 times, the Prize of the Ecumenical Jury 3 times, more than any other director, and the Grand Prix Special du Jury twice. He was also nominated for the Palme d'Or 2 times. In 1987, the British Academy of Film and Television Arts awarded the BAFTA Award for Best Foreign Language Film to The Sacrifice. Under the influence of glasnost and perestroika, Tarkovsky was finally recognized in the Soviet Union in the autumn of 1986, shortly before his death, by a retrospective of his films in Moscow. After his death, an entire issue of the film magazine Iskustvo Kino was devoted to Tarkovsky. In their obituaries, the Film Committee of the Council of Ministers of the USSR and the Union of Soviet Filmmakers expressed their sorrow that Tarkovsky had to spend the last years of his life in exile. Posthumously, he was awarded the Lenin Prize in 1990, one of the highest state honors in the Soviet Union. In 1989, the Andrei Tarkovsky Memorial Prize was established, with its first recipient being the Russian animator Yuri Norshtin. In 3 consecutive events, the Moscow International Film Festival awards the annual Andrei Tarkovsky Award in the years of 1993, 1995 and 1997. In 1996 the Andrei Tarkovsky Museum opened in Yuryevets, his childhood town. A minor planet, 3345 Tarkovsky, discovered by Soviet astronomer Ludmila Georgievna Karachkina in 1982, has also been named after him. Tarkovsky has been the subject of several documentaries. Most notable is the 1988 documentary Moscow Elegy, by Russian film director Alexander Sokurov. Sokurov's own work has been heavily influenced by Tarkovsky. The film consists mostly of narration over stock footage from Tarkovsky's films. directed by Andrei Tarkovsky, is 1988 documentary film by Mihail Ishalowski, an editor of the film The Sacrifice. Film director Chris Marker produced the television documentary One Day in the Life of Andrei Arsenyevich as an homage to Andrei Tarkovsky in 2000. And Ingmar Bergman was quoted as saying, "Tarkovsky for me is the greatest, of us all, the one who invented a new language, true to the nature of film, as it captures life as a reflection, life as a dream." Film historian Stephen Dillon says that much of subsequent film was deeply influenced by the films of Tarkovsky. At the entrance to the Gerasimov Institute of Cinematography in Moscow, Russia, there is a monument that includes statues of Tarkovsky, Gennady Shpalikov, and Vasily Shukshin. Concentrate, is a never-filmed 1958 screenplay by Russian film director Andrei Tarkovsky. The screenplay is based on Tarkovsky's year in the taiga as a member of a research expedition, prior to his enrollment in film school. It's about the leader of a geological expedition, who waits for the boat that brings back the concentrates collected by the expedition. The expedition is surrounded by mystery, and its purpose is a state secret. Although some authors claim that the screenplay was filmed, according to Marina Tarkovskaya, Tarkovsky's sister, and wife of Alexander Gordon, a fellow student of Tarkovsky during his film school years, the screenplay was never filmed. Tarkovsky wrote the screenplay during his entrance examination at the State Institute of Cinematography, GIK, in a single sitting. He earned the highest possible grade, excellent, for this work. In 1994, fragments of the concentrate were filmed and used in the documentary Andrei Tarkovsky's Taiga Summer by Marina Tarkovskaya and Alexander Gordon. Hoffmanniana is a never-filmed 1974 screenplay by Russian film director Andrei Tarkovsky. The screenplay is based on the life and work of German author E.T.A. Hoffmann. In 1974, an acquaintance from Tallinn Film approached Tarkovsky to write a screenplay on a German theme. Tarkovsky considered Thomas Mann and E.T.A. Hoffmann, and also thought about Ibsen's Peer Gynt. In the end, Tarkovsky signed a contract for a script based on the life and work of Hoffmann. Tarkovsky planned to write the script during the summer of 1974 at his dacha. Writing was not without difficulty. Less than a month before the deadline, he had not written a single page. He finally finished the project in late 1974 and submitted the final script to Tallinn Film in October. Although the script was well received by the officials at Tallinn Film, it was the consensus that no one but Tarkovsky would be able to direct it. The script was sent to Goskino in February 1976, and although approval was granted for proceeding with making the film, the screenplay was never realized. In 1984, during the time of his exile in the West, Tarkovsky revisited the screenplay and made a few changes. He also considered to finally direct a film based on the screenplay but ultimately dropped this idea. Tarkovsky became a film director during the mid and late 1950s, a period referred to as the Khrushchev thaw, during which Soviet society opened to foreign films, literature and music, among other things. This allowed Tarkovsky to see films of European, American and Japanese directors, an experience which influenced his own filmmaking. His teacher and mentor at the film school, Mikhail Rom, allowed his students considerable freedom and emphasized the independence of the film director. Tarkovsky was, according to fellow student Shavkat Abdusalmov, fascinated by Japanese films. He was amazed by how every character on the screen is exceptional and how everyday events such as a samurai cutting bread with his sword are elevated to something special and put into the limelight. Tarkovsky has also expressed interest in the art of haiku and its ability to create images in such a way that they mean nothing beyond themselves. Tarkovsky perceived that the art of cinema has only been truly mastered by very few filmmakers, stating in a 1970 interview with Naum Abramov that they can be counted on the fingers of one hand. In 1972, Tarkovsky told film historian Leonid Kozlov his 10 favorite films. The list includes Diary of a Country Priest and Mouchette by Robert Bresson, Winter Light, Wild Strawberries, and Persona by Ingmar Bergman, Nazarene by Luis Buñuel, City Lights by Charlie Chaplin, Ugetsu by Kenji Mizoguchi, Seven Samurai by Akira Kurosawa, and Woman in the Dunes by Hiroshi Tashigahara. Among his favorite directors were Buñuel, Mizoguchi, Bergman, Bresson, Kurosawa, Michelangelo Antonioni, Jean Vigo, and Carl Theodor Dreyer. With the exception of City Lights, the list does not contain any films of the early silent era. The reason is that Tarkovsky saw film as an art as only a relatively recent phenomenon, with the early filmmaking forming only a prelude. The list has also no films or directors from Tarkovsky's native Russia, although he rated Soviet directors such as Boris Barnett, Sergei Parajanov and Alexander Dovzhenko highly. He said of Dovzhenko's Earth, "I have lived a lot among very simple farmers and met extraordinary people. They spread calmness, had such tact, they conveyed a feeling of dignity and displayed wisdom that I have seldom come across on such a scale." Dovzhenko had obviously understood wherein the sense of life resides. This trespassing of the border between nature and mankind is an ideal place for the existence of man. Dovzhenko understood this. Although strongly opposed to commercial cinema, in a famous exception Tarkovsky praised the blockbuster film The Terminator, saying its vision of the future and the relation between man and its destiny is pushing the frontier of cinema as an art. He was critical of the brutality and low acting skills, but was nevertheless impressed by the film. In a 1962 interview, Tarkovsky argued, "All art, of course, is intellectual, but for me, all the arts, and cinema even more so, must above all be emotional and act upon the heart." His films are characterized by metaphysical themes, extremely long takes, and images often considered by critics to be of exceptional beauty. Recurring motifs are dreams, memory, childhood, running water accompanied by fire, rain indoors, reflections, levitation, and characters reappearing in the foreground of long panning movements of the camera. He once said, "Juxtaposing a person with an environment that is boundless, collating him with a countless number of people passing by, closeto him and far away, relating a person to the whole world, that is the meaning of cinema." Tarkovsky incorporated levitation scenes into several of his films, most notably Solaris. To him these scenes possess great power and are used for their photogenic value and magical inexplicability. Water, clouds, and reflections were used by him for their surreal beauty and photogenic value, as well as their symbolism, such as waves or the forms of brooks or running water. Bells and candles are also frequent symbols. These are symbols of film, sight and sound, and Tarkovsky's film frequently has themes of self-reflection. Tarkovsky developed a theory of cinema that he called sculpting in time. By this he meant that the unique characteristic of cinema as a medium was to take our experience of time and alter it. Unedited movie footage transcribes time in real time. By using long takes and few cuts in his films, he aimed to give the viewers a sense of time passing, time lost, and the relationship of one moment in time to another. Up to, and including, his film Mirror, Tarkovsky focused his cinematic works on exploring this theory. After Mirror, he announced that he would focus his work on exploring dramatic unities proposed by Aristotle, a concentrated action, happening in one place, within the span of a single day. Several of Tarkovsky's films have color black and white sequences. This first occurs in the otherwise monochrome Andrei Rublev, which features a color epilogue of Rublev's authentic religious icon paintings. All of his films afterwards contain monochrome, and in Stalker's case sepia sequences, while otherwise being in color. In 1966, in an interview conducted shortly after finishing Andrei Rublev, Tarkovsky dismissed color film as a commercial gimmick and cast doubt on the idea that contemporary films meaningfully use color. He claimed that in everyday life one does not consciously notice colors most of the time, and that color should therefore be used in film mainly to emphasize certain moments, but not all the time, as this distracts the viewer. To him, films in color were like moving paintings or photographs, which are too beautiful to be aerialistic depiction of life. Bergman on Tarkovsky. Ingmar Bergman, a renowned director, commented on Tarkovsky contrarily. However, Bergman conceded the truth in the claim made by a critic who wrote that, with Autumn Sonata Bergman does Bergman, adding, "Tarkovsky began to make Tarkovsky films, and that Fellini began to make Fellini films, Buñuel nearly always made Buñuel films." This pastiche of one's own work has been derogatorily termed as self-karaoke. Tarkovsky worked in close collaboration with cinematographer Vadim Yazov from 1958 to 1972, and much of the visual style of Tarkovsky's films can be attributed to this collaboration. Tarkovsky would spend 2 days preparing for Yazov to film a single long take, and due to the preparation, usually only a single take was needed. In his last film, The Sacrifice, Tarkovsky worked with cinematographer Sven Nykvist, who had worked on many films with director Ingmar Bergman. Nykvist was not alone. Several people involved in the production had previously collaborated with Bergman, notably lead actor Erland Josephson, who had also acted for Tarkovsky in Nostalgia, Nyquist complained that Tarkovsky would frequently look through the camera and even direct actors through it. Notes. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.